So I'll be talking about supporting soft real-time tasks in Zen. And this work was published in V 2010. So what are we looking at here? What's the problem statement? What we want to do is to see if we have a mix of workloads, some of the workloads being real-time workloads and some of the workloads being non-real-time workloads. How do we have real-time workloads get the resource that they need without starving the non-real-time workloads? So the main goal of the work is to use the existing credit scheduler, modify it, and see how it works with a real-time workload. And the target application that we study is doing media in an IP telephony system. And I'll talk about more about the target application further down in the talk. So what's the requirement of a real-time application? In this case, the real-time application that we are talking about is a media server. Now, what does a media server do? The job of the media server is to pick up packets, pick each packet up, do some kind of processing on it, it might be transcoding, and then put the packet back on the network. And the media server could be handling, let's say, hundreds of streams, sometimes thousands of streams. So the media server effectively is highly I/O bound because it's picking up packets and doing something with them and then dropping and handing them back to the network. At the same time, it needs compute resources because it has to process the packets. So what are the challenges that we see when you deploy this on Zen? First of all, of course, since it is I/O bound, there's I/O virtualization overhead that comes in. Then we have this problem that, let's say, for media packets like voice. What voice needs is that the jitter in the packets should be too much variability in the packets. So you pick up a packet, you process it in a given time, and then put it back. So if there is a scheduling latency which is very variable that negatively impacts the packet processing and the packet delivery and the voice quality of the voice that is being delivered. So that is one challenge we need to overcome for when we use Zen. The third problem is that if you have several workloads working together, there's cache contention, and you will have problems because of cache contention. So what we need to look at is to see if the existing scheduler handles these concerns, and if not, what can we do to make it better. So this is the target application that we have. It's an enterprise IP telephony system. Currently, if you deploy an IP telephony system, what you'd have is you'll have signaling servers. You might have SIP signaling servers. You might have the traditional signaling servers. You might have the media servers, and you'll deploy them as boxes in your network. Now, we at Avaya, what we're trying to do is to take these multi-server solution and consolidate it using Zen, so that we can deploy it for a small business in a one box. So single box solution would look something like this. There would be the signaling servers and the media servers sitting on the Zen hypervisor along with DOM 0. And there might be some other domains sitting alongside it used for management. So throughout my talk, I'll be talking about this configuration that we'll be deploying on top of Zen. So let's do a very brief overview of how existing credit scheduler handles things in Zen right now. And I'll be talking only about the aspects that impact the media. So how does it handle credits? So when you give each virtual machine some credits, or each vCPU some credits in some sense, and as the vCPUs run, they consume credits. And there is a notion of priority in the queues. There's under priority and over priority, which is under priority means that you still have credits to run, and over priority means you consumed all your credits. And the run queue is basically based on the priority. So every 30 milliseconds, the scheduler distributes credits based on the weights and gives the CPU based on the proportional distribution of the CPU based on weights. Now, how is I/O handled? So what happens is that a vCPU is usually waiting for some I/O. it gets woken up and gets boosted when event arrives. So when a packet arrives, the vCPU gets boosted up and gets into a boost priority. And the boost priority is just at the head of the queue. But the boost priority is very short duration. So it will get boosted up for, let's say, less than 10 milliseconds, and then it will go to the back of the queue when it gets preempted. So what's the problem with this? Okay, credit scheduler is very good for CPU-bound tasks or compute-intensive tasks, because what you're doing is you can give more and more credits and make your job use of the credits. As you can, so if you look at the graph there, that the graph has CPU bound on the x-axis and the latency on the y-axis. And compute-intensive tasks usually fall in the category of they don't care too much about latency, but they have high CPU requirements. And such kind of tasks will be good if you just give them high credits. Then the second kind of tasks are the IO tasks, low latency IO tasks, which usually what they do is they pick up a packet and then they do something with it, and they don't require too much CPU. For such tasks, the boost priority in the existing credit scheduler is very good. You basically do the job and then you're done. But then media has a problem, this in the sense that media needs low latency. At the same time, it needs CPU when it acquires more CPU time when it gets the CPU. And it needs this CPU in a timely manner. And what we see is that in the existing credit scheduler, there's no really a support for this, because the boost priority boosts up the pack, boosts and schedules the domain, but it schedules it a very short time. So what happens is that by the time the media server gets a chance to pick up the packet and handle the packet processing, it gets scheduled out. So what we propose is what we call as the laxity-based scheduler. And there are four components in the scheduler. The first is called what we define as laxity. The second is a variation of the boost. And then what we do is we also modify the load balancing and of the real-time and the non-real-time task to be more cache-aware. And through the rest of the talk, I'll be talking about each of these individual components and how they impact the behavior. So before I go into the experiments, I just want to talk about what the experimental setup was. So we had the enterprise telephony system deployed on Xen. It had the media server domain. It has a signaling server domain. And there was two other domains for licensing and management, but there was not too much going on there. Then we also introduced a computational domain. And the reason for doing that was to see how the workload would behave if there was a compute-intensive task sitting in parallel with the telephony applications. Okay? So we had two workload scenarios that we evaluate: standard, where there's no load on the computational domain, and the CPU load workload scenario, where we have some CPU-bound tasks on the domain. We used a Dell 2950 server it was two quad core, but we only used four cores because we wanted to experiment with not sharing of caches. So in this configuration, actually two cores share a cache. So we got rid of four cores and only used four of the cores. The load that we put on the system was at four calls per second, and we sampled one out of four calls to measure the performance. G711 codec, 20 millisecond packetization, and 30 second hold time. So there are about maximum of 240 streams going through the media server. So 240 streams of, and each stream having every 20 millisecond a packet. Now, how do we measure quality in this case? We use something called PESC, which is a standard ITU's way of measuring voice quality. And what we do is we compare a reference waveform with the waveform coming out of the media server and do a PESC between the two. Um, so we needed to do some additional instrumentation to see how our scheduler and credit scheduler were behaving under the workload. And we used Zentrace, we added custom events for Zentrace for collecting things like CPU utilization, wait times in the various parts of the run queue, whether how much was it waiting when it was in the boost cycle, how much was it waiting when it was in the under priority and the over priority, and also how much time it got scheduled from each priority. And we used XenoProf for measuring the cache misses. So just an overview of how to read the plots going forward in the talk. PESC, as I said, is a standard way of measuring voice quality. A value of 0 means very bad. A value of 4.5 is best quality that you can get. 4 is usually toll quality. That means when you make a phone call to AT&T, the quality that you expect is usually 4. The value is given as a box plot on the right. And as you can see, there's a vertical line at 4. So, and the bottom part of the top part is the box plot, and the bottom part is the CDF. So anything beyond that vertical line of 4 is good quality. And anything below this side is left side is bad quality. So you see here, that's poor quality, and that side is the good quality. So keep this in mind while we're looking through the experiments. So first, what we did was we took the default credit scheduler and saw how it performed, how our workload performed with the default credit scheduler. So what we wanted to see was if we just take the tunable parameters that the credit scheduler has, like weight, and change that, and how does it impact the workload? So we gave additional. So first, take a look at the base number. So base number default credit scheduler is the green line up there, the bottom. And as you can see, the green line, as you can see, the PESC values, about 50% of the calls are at below 4, which is not very good. Then what we did was we gave additional weights to the credit scheduler, a weight of 512 and 1024. And what you see is that the red line is the one where we have given a weight of 1024, and there's really no impact on the quality. Still, 50% of the calls are at very bad quality. So then we try to see, okay, what happens if we give, let the media server have whatever it wants by pinning. Okay? So we pinned the media server and we pinned the signaling server. And we pinned everybody away from those two servers, all the other domains. And as you can see from the blue line up there, we got significant performance gain. That means if you give the media server whatever it wants, in this case of a single CPU, then it's able to do whatever it needs to do. But of course, you are underutilizing the CPUs because you're using pinning, and you don't want to do that. So what we wanted to do was to take the credit scheduler and then start modifying it to see what we can get. No. So we had a 4-core system, just 8-core system. No, we trimmed down the number of cores just for experimentation purposes. I mean, it's not for, yeah. So that's what we get by pinning. Okay. So let's discuss now each component of the scheduler that we are proposing, and see how it impacts the performance. So we propose something called laxity. Laxity is some form of priority in the sense that you can, for a real-time domain, you can define a number and say, I want my domain to not have to wait in the run queue for more than, let's say, 5 milliseconds. Okay? And that's a parameter which is specified by the user. So real-time domains are given some kind of laxity value, and for non-real-time domains, it's no value specified, which is conceptually equal to having infinite laxity. That means it's allowed to wait longer, as long as it can, or as long as it goes. So how do we implement laxity? So basically, let's say if we specify a laxity for a domain as being 5 microseconds, we decide where it wants to go into the run queue. We decide where it goes in the run queue based on the expected run times of the vCPU sitting in the run queue. Okay? So in this case, a vCPU coming with a laxity value of 5 microseconds would be going in between the first and the second guy in the run queue. And vCPU coming with a laxity value of 20 microseconds would go between the third and the fourth guy in the run queue. And somebody who's a vCPU which has gotten boosted and has a laxity value of 20 microseconds would be put in the front of the run, behind the main first boost guy, but before the other under priority guys. So it maintains the priorities from the run queues of credit scheduler, but at the same time organizes the run queues such that the laxity values are somewhat met. It's a guideline to the scheduler, effectively. So if you look at these numbers that we have for each vCPU, 1 microsecond, 7 microseconds, this is the expected runtime of the vCPU. Now, how do we determine that? And how do we predict the wait time in the run queue? So what we do is, in the current implementation, we use a very simplistic approach. We basically take the amount of CPU, a vCPU utilized in the previous run, and use that as a guideline for expected runtime of that CPU, vCPU in the next cycle. And what we see is that predicting the wait time based on that works reasonably well in our case. So if you look at the graph on the right-hand side, that's a box plot of the difference between the expected and the actual wait times. And as you can see, most of the vCPUs are tracking the wait times pretty cleanly, except for a couple of them there. Of course, you can use a more sophisticated formula to predict the run times, but we didn't do that part in this work. So just with the laxity part, just by giving laxity values to real-time domains, we figure out the performance of the scheduler. And in this graph, you have to compare the green line with the red line and the blue line with the orange line. So green and red are basically the standard configuration, standard workload. And the blue and the orange are the when there is a compute-intensive workload running in parallel with the IP telephony workload. And as you can see, with the laxity value, if you look at the box plot, the red shifts more to the right as compared to the green. So that means there is an improvement in the PESC values. And that improvement is seen more clearly in the CPU load case when the system is really heavily loaded. The blue is the base case, and the orange, which is all the way to the right, is the CPU load case. So as you can see, we improved the performance a little bit, but not all the way, because what we want is effectively the graph to go all the way beyond the vertical line at 4. So the other tweaking that we did with the credit scheduler was that we changed the boost model a little bit. Because what happens is that when the media server is most of the time sitting in the under queue, that means it has credits to run and it has packets to process. But it's not really in the wait queue. It's not really waiting. And what happens is that in the existing credit scheduler, when a packet comes in, a vCPU goes into boost only if it is coming from the wait queue. But if the vCPU is sitting in the under priority in run queue, it does not get boosted. So we made a small modification here where we allowed a vCPU to be boosted even if it was sitting with under priority in the run queue. Now, that was the second component of the scheduler. Now we move on to the third component of the scheduler, which is the load balance. So I just want to quickly give a brief overview of what existing credit scheduler does for load balancing. So periodically, what the scheduler does is that a CPU, let's say in this case CPU 1, looks at its run queue, sees that it has only over or idle tasks in the run queue. So it peeks into the other CPU's queues and steals higher priority tasks from there. That's the default credit scheduler load balancing. So So what we did was we did a simple modification to that. So we look at the CPU looks at its own queue and sees if it has under, over, or idle task. Then it goes and peeks into the other CPU's queues and steals a higher priority task. And if what it also what it does is that if it has a real-time task in its own queue, it does not try to go and steal somebody else's task. But if it has a low priority task in its queue, and the other guy has a real-time task which is waiting in the queue, it will pick up the real-time task. But if both the tasks are non-real-time, it will compare the time that the vCPU entered the run queue, and if there's a big difference between the two, it will pick up the other guy's task. So how does this help us? So this effectively distributes real-time tasks over the CPUs and also prevents starvation of the non-real-time tasks, because it moves the non-real-time tasks if they have waited for some time in the run queue. So the simple algorithm that we presented just now, the L algorithm, is good. But what happens is that there's too much ping-ponging going on between the CPUs. So it trashes the cache. And the real-time domains do not like, the real-time task that media server does not like that. So to avoid that, what we did was we tried to nail down the real-time tasks and not load balance them. But then again, if you do that, it creates an unbalance in the system of the real-time tasks that are sitting on the CPUs. So you really don't want to do that either. So what we needed was a larger granularity of balancing the real-time tasks. So what we do now is in our cache-aware real-time load balancing algorithm, which we call LL, we move around the non-real-time tasks at a finer granularity. So they get moved around with every 200 milliseconds. But the real-time tasks get only moved around at 1 second intervals. And the way they get moved around is that we do some form of bin packing of the real-time tasks so that almost each physical CPU has approximately same amount of processing for real-time tasks done. So with these three changes, that is putting laxity in, putting in modifications for boost, and doing the load balancing, this is what we get. So again, here in this graph, the green line is the base credit scheduler. The blue line was, if you remember, the red line is the pinned configuration, which is what we wanted to achieve. And the blue line is the one with our scheduler, which is the laxity plus basic load balancing plus the cache-aware load balancing. And you can see the blue line tracks the red line very cleanly. So in addition to seeing how our media server behaved with the new scheduler, we also wanted to see how the CPU intensive tasks that we loaded the system with, how they behaved, how they performed with our scheduler, so that we could say that we are not really starving them. So we just counted the iterations that the CPU bound tasks had to do were allowed to do in the various parts of the load balancer, various parts of the scheduler. So if you look at this graph, what it shows is that on the y scale are the amount of work done by the CPU load tasks, and on the x scale are the policies. So the first graph is the baseline pinned configuration, where obviously, since you are taking away resources from the CPU load tasks, they won't be able to do as much work. And the second set of bars are the baseline numbers. That means the default credit scheduler, where it's allowed to do a use of whatever CPU it wants to do. And the three right graphs are for our laxity scheduler and the laxity with simple load balancing and the more cache-aware load balancing. As you can see, the amount of work being done by the CPU intensive tasks in this case is pretty similar to the baseline case. So we feel that we are fully utilizing the CPUs with our load balancer and with our algorithm. Now let's take a look at the cache misses. If you look at this graph on the left, this is the graph of the box plot of the total cache misses. and the graph on the right breaks it down by the various various domains. So total cache misses definitely go down, as well as the cache misses for the media server also significantly go down, and that's why you see an improvement in the performance. So as you saw, the laxity component had some impact on the performance, but a lot of the impact came from the cache awareness of the load balancing algorithm. So the combination of the two basically gave us a very good performance, and the cache misses went down significantly. So, concluding, we proposed a new soft real-time aware scheduler for Xen, which had better support for real-time applications without penalizing the non-real-time applications. And it was fully utilizing the CPU resources. And the key concept that we introduced was a laxity component, which is the timeliness requirement for the domain. Thank you.
Just a moment, before going to the questions, is the third speaker present here? Okay, thank you very much. Okay, let's go to the questions.
In the mix of workloads that you're mentioning, right, you're using the CPU workloads. What's the memory footprint of those CPU workloads?
Oh, there's not too much of memory footprint for those.
So that has a lot of impact on the cache thing, right? Cache state.
So remember when I said that there are multiple domains there? They're like there were about six domains in all, and all the domains were doing some work.
But still, like I would assume, like you know, because the mix of workloads doesn't include heavily memory-intensive workloads too, or I mean, like you know, with workloads with large memory footprint.
Right.
A lot of cache benefit is
to look at to see how the if there were memory impacting workloads and how this get impacted.
Yeah.
We haven't looked at that. Yeah. So.
Yeah, hi. On one of your slides, I didn't quite understand. You were saying that in the run queue, one of the VCUs would yield to the vCPU with real time. But how do you know that this is the real time task here in the hypervisor?
Like, how do you know? We enhance the data structures inside to keep track of which tasks, which vCPUs are from the real time domain and which vCPUs are not from the real time domain.
Okay, so all the vCPUs belonging to a certain domain are considered
are,
that.
Yeah, classified in real time. Right.
Okay, all right.
Yeah. Any other questions?
So what is the plan going forward? So I think yesterday we heard a talk from George about scheduler. So is there any
right.
plans of merging this or having this as an option or something upstream?
So for the timing, we're talking to George, and we'll be giving our workload to George so that he can experiment with credit too to see how it behaves in under the media part behaves under his scheduler. That's the plan going forward.
Maybe one more question?
Pardon, can you repeat the question?
Not only the major server, but also the server applications or server or
database
server.
Okay. You mean like an email server or a web server, that kind of applications? No, we haven't done any studies with that. We haven't taken our scheduler and applied it to general purpose workloads. We haven't done that yet.